In the first stage of a meditation practice, the goal is to get established into the practice. Yeah, and the good thing about these traditional meditation practices are that we have very clear specific goal in each stages, right? So our goal in the first stage is not to become master in the meditation. Our goal here is simply to get established into the practice. Now, if you take a look at this diagram, you will see in the first stage, the elephant is completely black, which means our mind is completely dominated by hindrances. We'll talk about the hindrances more in the next video, but for reference, there are five hindrances. One is one is more like a worldly sensual desires and aversion, and then there is a pair of agitation and dullness, and then there is a doubt, right? So these are like five hindrances which are completely and dominating our current state of mind. Then there is this monkey who is completely black also, which represents our scattered attention. So here it means like we don't have very much intentional control over our attention. It's scattered, and it's scattered very automatically, right? So we don't have much control there. The fire represents we need to put a lot of effort in the first stage, and probably the first stage is where you need to put the most effort. And then the meditator is having a goal, which is his intention and his diligence, the effort part. And then he has this rope, which is mindfulness, right? And with this two entities, he's going to tame this elephant. Okay, so this is like a very high level overview of what is the first level, first stage of our meditation. Now let's drill down and see what are the different steps we can take to make sure we are successful in our first stage. Yeah. So in the first stage, the more instruction there are, the better it is, right? And we need to know these instruction changes. So it may sound like there are a lot of instructions in the first stage, but as we progress, the instructions become less and less because we don't need so many instructions, right? So first reasonable thing that we can do in the first stage is to follow this six-step process. In the six-step process, the first step is our motivation, our intention or motivation, right? And the same thing that the monk is having, this intent, this weapon of intent, right? So we have a clear intent why we are practicing meditation, right? It could be very different for different people. It could be something like, you know, I have heard about this thing. This practice is going on for more than 5,000 years now. At least we know 5,000, who knows even more. So this practice is fairly long, sustained for such a long period of time. Let me give it a shot. Let me see what it is about, right? Now, it could be I'm feeling so much anxiety, so much fear, so much agitation, so much excitement that it's just like I cannot do what I'm doing, right? And I think meditation can help, and meditation can certainly help in that scenario, right? Or it could be something more deeper, like I want to see what exactly I am, or awakening and all these kind of stuff, right? It depends. Depends on person to person. But you can hold your attention, you can hold your intention that this is my intention for the practice and I'm going to do it. This is especially useful in the first stage. After maybe few stages, you don't need it so much because once you see the benefit of it, there is no doubt about it, right? But in first stage, we need an intention to hold, right? Then the second step in the six-step process, the second step would be to set a reasonable goal, right? And a reasonable goal could be something like for next 20 minutes, I'm going to do this meditation practice and I'm going to do my best to stay focused on my meditation object and not watch my time, you know, not watch my mobile or not just, you know, for any reason get out of my cushion, right? For that 20 minutes, no matter what happens, I'm going to sit down and I'm going to try my best to observe my meditation. If I was able to sit down for 20 minutes, I was successful, right? That's a fairly reasonable goal to set in the first stage. That we have like a intention. Again, it ties back to the intention. We are strong. We are like strengthening our intention in this stage as much as we can. The third step in the process is make sure your expectations are clear. Your mind, this mind training, you have to understand that mind is not under your direct control. And it's very powerful, right? So mind is so much scattered, mind is, so much lethargic. I am having these kind of thoughts or I am having all these kind of negative imagination. Whatever it is, you have to understand that you are not doing this. This is automatic. This is happening in the mind. You're just, you know, learning to observe it, or you are learning to, you know, master your attention. All these things, don't own them. You're not doing them. They're happening by themselves. And so let them happen, right? So have a fair expectation. It's not like for 20 minutes I will sit down and all of a sudden I have a focus for 20 minutes on my breath. And that's just not reasonable, right? So keep your expectation light, right? If you were able to sit down for 20 minutes in the first stage, that's a big success. Then the fourth step would be check your obstacles, right? The mind is going to be disturbed, and it is going to be disturbed about what you are most disturbed about, right? So everybody is facing some obstacle in their life. It could be anything. It could be your health. It could be your social life or relationship. It could be your career. Anything that you're probably going through, an agitated state in that specific area. So important thing again here to understand here is these obstacles are going to pull your attention. And what we want to do here is, again, strengthen our attention that I'm going to solve these problems. It's not like I'm, you know, going to put them off. I'm going to solve it, but not in these 20 minutes. In these 20 minutes, I'm just going to do my meditation and focus on my breath, right? So I'm not going to get engaged in this daydreaming kind of stuff, right? And the fifth step in this process is diligence. So you make a strong commitment that you are going to do that, right? Again, everything is tied back to the intention. Everything is tied back to this holding a strong intention and this effortful weapon that is required in the first step. And the sixth step in the process is you want to have like a very stable posture, right? So your spine has to be straight, your back has to be straight, your neck has to be straight. You can take support of a wall, you can use a chair, or you can sit in a cushion. Again, it's not very important in the first stage to refine everything, right? What is most important is you are able to establish the practice. And so it's not really so much important that you put so much effort into the posture. If you're good in the posture, you can have like a more stable posture. But if anyhow you can keep your back, neck and spine straight with some support, that's completely okay too, right? So these are the six-step process that you follow, which will make your intention even more stronger, and you can start the practice more fruitfully, right? Now, when you try to do this, of course, you're going to keep forgetting. It's not going to get so smoothly, and that's also okay because you're still having your intention on something, right? And following these kind of processes also helps to, you know, not waste time in the meditation. Otherwise, what is going to happen is you're going to just sit down and maybe just daydream, or, you know, think something and come out like, okay, this meditation is not for me. I don't know what I was thinking doing this, right? So the first, so I will recommend to follow this six-step process to just getting established, at least for a week or so. So you start to get the sense of it, you start to get established in the practice and achieve the goal of the first stage, right? So once we follow the six-step process, the second important thing here is to have a meditation object, right? There could be many meditation objects. There could be a mantra that you can do the japa in the mind. You can have some kind of imagination that you can focus your mind. To gain the stable attention, we need to have some kind of object that we are directing our attention towards for a long period of time. That's a requirement there, right? So here in this practice, the meditation object is basically a breath, right? And it's a very interesting object, and I would say it's a more superior object as compared to other object, right? Why is that? Why the breath is an object which is more useful for us to cultivate our mindfulness and this stable attention. So many things about breath. The first thing is breath is always in the present moment. So we are learning to stay focused on an object which is in the present moment. So we are learning to stay focused in the present moment as well, right? The second thing could be the breath is also something which is naturally happening. So we are looking at some natural phenomena, right? We are not, when I'm doing a japa or when I'm doing some kind of object in like visualizing some object, I am creating that reality, right? It's not something that is happening naturally. And in the case of breath, I'm not creating breath. Breath is coming and going, and I'm just observing them, right? So it is something which is happening naturally. And that allows me to get the sense of nature of reality. They're building the insight, which it is very useful in the sense of, you know, seeing thing as it is, which is going to be even more useful in the later stages, you know. Okay, other than that, breath is very neutral object. I don't have very strong attachment or aversion toward breath, right? So I'm not craving for breath. So again, when you focus, when you observe your mind long enough, you will see it is so restless, or it's so anxious, or it's like different things are happening in the mind because of the root cause of attachment to something, right? Here I'm running to be seeing something which is neutral, right? So it has this element of neutrality. So, and then the breath is also a very dynamic object, right? So when I'm, and it is very connected to my mind. So when I'm restless, when mind is, you know, there's a lot of thoughts going on, a lot of emotions, a lot of disturbance going on. In that case, the breath is more gross, right? More strong. So I can observe the breath more easily, right? On the other hand, when the mind is settled down and I'm, you know, calm and peaceful and tranquil, in that case, the breath become very subtle, very fine. So my object of attention changes based on my state of mind, right? So in the disturbed state of mind, I need a strong object to stay focused on, right? On the other hand, when my mind is stable and fine, in that case, I need something more refined to, you know, sharpen my focus. And breath does it very beautifully. It changes according to the state of my mind. And then it is always present, right? It's, you can always stay focused on the breath, no matter where you are, whether you're sleeping or whatever you're doing. You can always stay focused on the breath, right? There's many, many, many other reasons for breath to have to make breath such an important object of attention, to cultivate this stable attention and mindfulness. So the breath, I would suggest to use breath as a meditation object in this practice, right? Okay, so we have our 6-step process to get established in the practice. We have our meditation object. Now what we want to do is we want to look at what could be, how do we move into the meditation, right? So again, because it is the first stage of the meditation practice, we want to have as much instructions as possible, right? That helps us to strengthen our intention. So the way we want to move into our meditation object is we first start with whole body, you know, we just sit down and we look at the whole body sensation, right? It is like a very strong, very big, you know, area for attention to focus on. So in that case, it's slightly easier as compared to when we focus on something more sharper. So we move step by step to our more stable, you know, sharper place to focus on. Okay, so we start, we just sit down, we relax, we start, we sit down. If requires, take some deep breaths to even relax yourself more. And we went through our 6-step process, and then we sit down and we look at our whole breath. We look at the whole body sensation, right? Just to ground ourselves. The second step would be is to, you know, take a look at the whole breath. And we don't have to spend so much time, just maybe 1 or 2 minutes looking at that, and then you move into the breath. And this is all so that we get settled down, right? And then we can start our meditation. The second step is, you know, to shorten it and just look at the whole breath. You start from the inhale, you go all the way down, and you exhale, you go all the way up, out, right? So you can take a look at the whole in-breath and out-breath, and that will allow you to, you know, shrinking your area of meditation. And at the same time, you're getting a little bit more relaxed in the process, right? Then we even sharpen, you know, shorten our focus of attention. So we can focus on the complete nostril area. That is still a big area to still focus on. So we can look at that area. We can see what sensation we are getting in terms of our breath, right? Breath is moving from our one nostril or both nostril. Breath is, you know, it's more warm or more cold or more long or more short, or all these kind of stuff we can observe in the area of our nostril, right? In this whole nostril area. And ultimately, we want to get to the point where our focus is on the tip of the nose. We only focus here. That allow our attention to, you know, be stable and sharp. And the more sharper the object of our attention, the more tendency the mind is to, you know, not stay there, to get scattered. The stronger the area, mind can still stay, but the sharper the area, it is harder for the mind. So we want to gradually move into that area. And then in that area, we want to stay focused. We want to stay focused. We want to see what the sensation of the breath when it comes in that area, when we inhale and when we exhale, we want to see the sensation of breath in the same area. So that is our practice. Start from the whole body, move to the breath, move to the bigger area, and then ultimately settle down to the precise area where we are looking at the breath and the sensation it creates in that area. So that is the third step, you can say. The first step would be just, you know, the going through six-step process. The second step is we know what is our meditation object. The third step is we are moving from, you know, larger to smaller area to stay focused on. Now, when we do this practice, of course, there's going to be some challenges. And that is very common, and we can address them because everybody kind of faces them, right? So first time you are going to do the meditation, it's going to be some enlightening experience, right? I remember when I did first time around 6 years back, I was just surprised, like, what the heck is this? what my mind is doing, right? I couldn't stay focused for, I don't remember, maybe like 5-10 seconds at max, right? That's a very interesting, you know, realization that our mind is so much out of control. And it might feel like this meditation thing might not be for me. That's not the right attitude to look at. It is like this for everybody, right? Everybody faces the same kind of, maybe some people might be a little bit more scattered, but when you start your practice, it is guaranteed that you're going to face it, right? It's guaranteed that you're going to feel very disturbed, and that's why we are having a meditation practice to solve that problem. So don't judge yourself based on, you know, sitting in the first meditation session for 20 minutes and seeing like, okay, this is not for me, right? So that's a very common thing. Expect like mind is going to be agitated, and it's given, right? And with the practice, that's why we are practicing, and with the practice, we will see the improvement there. Second thing could be like, I don't have time, I'm very busy, I don't have time for meditation. So again, it's important to understand why it is so, why we want to practice something like meditation, right? Many fold reasons for different people, the reasons could be different, but you have to see through yourself what is our current state of mind and how we are going about living our life, because it is directing our life. It is directing our action, right? A meditation practice will let you see that, you know. And the more sharper and more stable state of mind we have, the more productive we are. You know, it's almost like, at the very least, it is almost like, you know, exercising. You can say, I don't have time for exercise, but that time invested in exercise, that time well invested, right? In the long run, it's going to reap amazing fruits. And also, it allows you to do whatever you are doing more productively, right? In the same way, meditation, at the very least, you can see it as a, you know, mental exercise. That if more stable attention you have, the better you are and the more productive you are going to be in terms of your work or whatever you think is more important. And it is just going to raise your quality of life, right? And then if you have, you might be even interested in more deeper aspect of the meditation, like, you know, that understanding of the nature of the way things are, why I'm so dissatisfied, why is this mind is so restless and all these kind of stuff. So it depends. But any way you look at it, it's a well-invested time, right? And 20 minutes, you can start with 20 minutes, and 20 minutes is something that you can make. If you don't have time, you can still make. You can wake up 20 minutes earlier and you can do it that way. But understand the importance of it. And once you have done it for some time, then you will know, then you don't have this time issue. Okay. Then another problem is, see, the meditation is not something which is going to be very enjoyable experience, right? It is going to be somewhat frustrating, especially in the beginning. And it's going to be it's not it's just not something fun and enjoyable to do in the beginning, right? You're going to struggle and all this thing. So very naturally, you're going to procrastinate for it, right? Okay, maybe I'll do it later. I'm not in a hurry. Or while you're doing the meditation, you can, you know, be more reluctant to do it. You can think about all the things instead of focusing on the meditation object. You can work your way through this procrastination and reluctance. You can set up a clear goal like, okay, for 7 days, I'm going to do this. That's it, right? You can, you know, sharpen your intention more. Or you can, you know, there's many ways you can tackle it. But these are like more common kind of issues that everybody faces. I don't have enough time, procrastination. I'm not, you know, meditation. I'm not good for meditation. I'm not able to do the meditation. All these things are very common problems. And these are the kind of the things we want to, you know, master in the stage one. So once we are done with the stage one, we establish in the practice, we have no more these kind of issues.